The Gospel of Mark, chapter 6. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 6. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 6. Mark, the 6th chapter. Start at verse 33, Mark 6 and 33. Let us stand for the reading and reverence of God's Word. Translation of the Bible, so it may read a little bit differently than yours. If you want to go exactly with what I'm reading, it's up there on the screens in front of you or behind you where you can be able to read along. And it reads this: but many people recognized them and saw them leaving, and people from many towns ran ahead along the shore and got there ahead of them. Jesus saw the huge crowd as he stepped from the boat, and he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. Late in the afternoon, verse 35, his disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place and it's already getting late. Send the crowd away so they can go to the nearby farms and villages and buy something to eat." But Jesus said, "Get this, you feed them." "With what?" they asked. "We'd have to work for months to earn enough money to buy food for all these people." "How much bread do you have?" Jesus asked. "Tell them, go and find out." They came back and reported, "We have 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Then Jesus told the disciples to have the people sit down in groups on the grass. So they sat down in groups of 50 or 100. Jesus took the 5 loaves and 2 fish, looked up towards heaven, and blessed them. Then, breaking the loaves into pieces, he kept giving the bread to the disciples so they can distribute it to the people. He also divided the fish for everyone to share. They all ate as much as they wanted. And afterwards, the disciples picked up 12 baskets of leftover bread and fish." I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, "Neighbor, the preacher's going to talk about ministry that matters. Ministry that matters. Ministry that matters." You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Ministry that matters. Ministry that matters. God, I thank you. God, I praise you. God, I glorify you and I lift you up. God, open our ears that we may hear. Give us hearts to obey everything that you said in your word. In Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Ministry that matters. I pray you all hear my heart today. Trying to shout us today, not trying to make us run, do any of those things. If you do, praise God, good for you today. Hallelujah. But if not, that's not my goal or my desire for this morning. But for you all to really hear, really have a heart to hear God's word this morning. I had a dream about a week ago. I've had several dreams. God deals with me in my dreams. And sometimes when it comes to things concerning the ministry and what's next or what to prepare for, what God is about to do, he deals with me in my dreams. And so prior, a few years ago, I always had these dreams where the church was just packed out. I mean, just overrunning with people. But I was never ready. I was never prepared, Elder James. I was always one dream. I was running around here, Sister Baker, in some sweatpants, trying to get to the back so I could be able to change, put my clothes on, and just, I was never ready. Several dreams, back to back, Sister Greta had these dreams, and I would talk to Elder Hodges. Everybody needs an interpreter in their life to help them make sense of their dreams, and so she's my Joseph, amen, in my life, to help me to be able to discern some stuff with my dreams, and so I shared that. And so recently, last week, I had this dream where I'm standing right here. I was prepared. I was ready. I'm preaching. And it may have been maybe 20, 25 people out sitting. And I'm preaching my heart out. I can't hear what I'm saying, but I'm preaching. I know I'm preaching. I'm preaching good. I even think I lost a little weight too, because I have a shirt tucked in. Thank you, Jesus, the weight loss. Hallelujah. So I'm preaching and I'm preaching, and all of a sudden, while I'm preaching, there's a young lady that approaches the altar. And so I shift from preaching and I go down to the altar and I begin to pray for the young lady. As I'm praying from the young lady, something, my discernment goes off. No, there's something deeper than just her coming down and asking for prayer, for provision to be to build. There's something. We're wrestling with the demon here that's in this girl. And so I signal for someone to come and help me pray for this young lady. And so we're praying for this young lady, and she gets free. Lady, she gets free. She's free from whatever it was. And so I stand up and I look out into the crowd. Every pew is filled to the max. Yeah. Standing room only in the back. I mean, people just, I don't even know where they came from. I don't even know what happens, but I'm sitting there praying with the girl. I went down, there's about 20, 25 people here in the building. I get back up, the church is packed out. And so I woke up from a dream. Oh, God, you could let me sleep another 15, 20 minutes. I wanted to see what the rest of the dream was about. You know, and plus I want another extra 15, 20 minutes of sleep too. I don't know. Y'all know what that's like, you know. And so I wrestled with this dream. And so last Wednesday, I called Elder Hodges and said, hey, I said, great, I need you to help me try to discern this dream. I said, I think I know what it means, but I just need some further confirmation on what this is. What is it that God is saying to me? What is it that he's trying to get me to see? What is it that he's alarming me that is on the way? This dream is so different from the dreams prior, because I was never ready. I was never prepared. I was always trying to get myself together. I was always running around here doing something else that somebody else should have been doing, or I could have delegated to somebody else. But this time, I'm ready. I'm prepared. I'm in position. God, what is it that you're doing? My mind went to this text right here in Mark chapter 6. Mark chapter 6. Jesus here. If you start off in the first part of the of chapter 6, Jesus is here. He's dealing over in verses 12 to 13. He's sending out the disciples to go and to be able to do ministries. He's given them power. He's given them anointing. They've been with him for such a time now that they have trained. He's trained them. He's developed them. They had firsthand experience to be one of the greatest teachers in ministry. They've seen Jesus work. They've seen Jesus operate. So now he said, after all the things that you've seen, all the things that you've heard, now all the exposure that I've given you, now I am putting my hands on you. Now I'm releasing you to go out.
Yeah, all right.
And to do the same thing that you've seen me do. So they go out. And so right there, I think it's in verse 30 or 31, the disciples are tired now. They just get back from this ministry endeavor. I can forget about my dream. I'm going to come back to it in just a minute. And so they get back from this ministry endeavor. So they're tired. They're ready to rest. They're ready to take a cool drink and just sit down and relax. And they're telling Jesus everything that has gone on. Celebrating the fact of all the victories that they've seen. They're celebrating the fact of the deliverance that they've seen, the breakthrough that they've seen, how they've seen people get saved, how they've seen people get healed and delivered. And so now Jesus says, okay, listen, now it's time to rest. Let's go ahead and let's go off somewhere, because we know that we got to go off somewhere, because if we don't go off somewhere and the people see us, they're going to come because they're going to want to minister, because they've seen what we do. And so as Jesus is on his way to take his disciples to a place where they can be able to rest and just chill out for a second, the Bible says in verse 23, but many people recognized him and saw them leaving, and people came from towns, ran ahead along the shore, and got there ahead of them. So they had just seen, they heard, news had traveled. They didn't have Facebook back then, they didn't have Twitter, they didn't have Snapchat and Instagram and stuff like that. So word traveled by mouth about what the disciples, how God had used them, how the Holy Spirit had used them to be able to impact the lives of so many. And so they beat the disciples to the location before they could even get there. Why did the disciples beat them? Why did the people beat the disciples to the destination before they got there? It was was something about the ministry of the disciples that attracted the people so. They had seen something they had never seen before. They had heard something that they had never heard before. Get the sense of God. Ministry that matters. You might want to write this down. You might want to tweet this. You might want to put this on Facebook. You might want to take a picture of these words and put it on Instagram. Pastor, I'm not going to take a picture of your words and put it on Instagram. I don't know. I just said it. Want to see if you're going to follow through and do it. The first thing about ministry that matters. Ministry that matters is attractive. It's attractive.
Yeah.
Ministry that matters. Ministry, by the way, let me go ahead and say stop real quick. Ministry. What is ministry, Pastor? So ministry is about serving people. Okay, let me go to this side over here. Ministry is about serving people. Okay, let me go right here to these two center sections right here. Ministry is about serving people. We cannot get to a place that we think that everything that we do is about an event, it's about an activity, it's about going somewhere. Ministry is about serving people. For 113 years, through danger seen and unseen, God has positioned us, God has blessed us to be able to serve people. And because of that, people have found what we do as we're serving Jesus to make him famous, to be attractive. Why did the people see what the disciples were doing as attractive? Look at verse 12 and 13. Your answer is right there. I'm just going to take my time just a little bit this morning. Since I got my voice back, so I'm a little happy about that. Look at verse 12 and 13. It says, so the disciples went out, telling everyone everyone they met, to repent of their sins and turn to God. And they cast out many demons and healed many sick people, anointed them with olive oil. Oh my goodness. And so when they heard about this in verse 13, and they saw in verse 33 that they were getting ready to leave, they said, oh no, then you're not leaving us right here. We're going to beat you down to the punch, because we've seen Jesus do use you all in ways that we've never seen before. We've seen you do things that we've never seen any man do. We've seen you operate in some type of power that we know not of. And we need to get to where you are so that we can be able to experience what you're doing. Oh my goodness, hope well. We ought to never take for granted how God is adding to our body. We must never take for granted how God is using us. We must never take for granted for what God is doing in our midst. But we should be excited at the fact that Jesus, there is something that we're doing as we're making you famous that is a drawing card and leading people to this place. This Jesus, there's something that you're doing in this house that you're pleased with, that you're able to trust us with more people, to be able to lead them, to be able to guide them, to be able to disciple them. But what was the underlying factor of this ministry that the disciples performed? The people were attracted by the power that the disciples operated in. Oh, I wish I had a church in here with me today this morning. The people were attracted by the power that the disciples operated in. This was not just some ordinary power. This was not just some power, but this was the power of the Holy Ghost that Jesus gave them. He said, the same thing that I'm doing, I'm now going to lay my hands on you so that you can be able to go out and do the very same thing that I've done, Pastor Swift. What are you saying to us? I'm saying to us that God is calling for Hopewell to operate in his might and operate in his power. All the best tools, what does it mean for us to be able to operate in his might, to operate in his power? That means that we have to follow the same model that Jesus followed, Pastor Smith. What are you talking about? Several times when you look in the New Testament, and whenever Jesus had did great ministry, he always broke away from the crowd and he went somewhere and isolated himself to spend time with his Father. I'm preaching already. I got no help right there. That whenever Jesus did big ministry, he found time to break away from the noise so that he could be able to get with his Father and spend some time with him so that he could be able to hear the next assignment that his Father had for his life. Oh, So what are you saying, Pastor Lewis? If we're going to follow the same model of Jesus, if we're going to operate in the same power that Jesus operated in, that means that we got to do the same thing that Jesus did. If Jesus prayed, that means that you and I need to pray. If Jesus fasted, that means that you and I need to fast. Oh my God, I wish I had a church in here today that could be able to testify to the fact that eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, all that God wants to do in this place. I know we got some guests this morning, but today you're a part of Team Hopewell this morning. I'll write a letter to your pastor and let them know that during these hours from 10 to about 12:30, if the Holy Ghost don't come, maybe 12:45, that you're a part of Team Hopewell. And God is challenging us today that if we're going to operate and continue to do another 113 years of ministry that matters, we must operate in His power. This is not just some ordinary power. This is not just some power, but this is power that He has given us access to. Somebody say access. Access. He's given us power. He's given us access to power that has the power to be able to change people's lives. Oh, that's ministry that matters. That's ministry that matters. That when you're doing ministry that has the power to change people's perspective, that has the power to influence people to change their hearts to follow Jesus. That's the ministry that matters. That when someone comes in and they're broken and they're busted and they're disgusted, and you give them ministry and you meet their needs and you disciple them, and then you see God transform their life. Use them in ways that they never seen before. But let me get back to this power. Let me get back to the access of this power. I'm telling you, church, that when we begin to pray over in the book of Acts, listen, this is nothing new. All this stuff I'm saying is right here in the Word of God. When you go through the book of Acts and you look at the first church, the Bible says that Peter was in prison. And the saints back at the house got word that Peter was in prison. And they didn't go around trying to figure out why is he in prison? What did Peter do? Now, the Bible says that the saints called for a prayer meeting right there on the spot. And they began to open up their mouths. And they began to pray. And they began to plead the blood of Jesus. And they began to pray that God would deliver Peter out of prison. And the Bible says that Peter came a knocking at the door. And a little girl came back and said, "Hey, y'all, Pastor Peter's at the door." They said, "Girl, get over there and sit down. You don't know what you're talking about." But listen here, they failed to realize that when you pray, you ought to expect God to meet your need. You ought to expect God to move. So God is telling the whole world that when you call on my name, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, then when you call on my name, expect me to show up. Oh, that's the access that He's given us. So I gotta slow down. That's the access to the power of prayer that He has given us. He has given us access to prayer, but we still won't take it. Oh, He has given us access to one of the greatest weapons that has the power to change Carbondale. He has given us power. He has given us access to the power that has the potential to change Southern Illinois. He has given us the access. The power of prayer that can turn on the northeast side of the Carbondale out, but we still fail to not pray. We still fail not to pray. The Bible says that Jesus was over in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights and He fasted. Oh, and there was a holy hush on the crowd. And Jesus fasted. Listen, He wasn't doing no Daniel's fast. He didn't have fruits and just vegetables. The Bible says that He had nothing, no water, no bread, nothing for 40 days and 40 nights. But the Bible tells us that when He came out of that fast, when He came out of the wilderness, that He had all the power and the might that He needed to be able to do ministry that matters. Pastor Swiss, what are you saying? That if we're going to tap into this next level of anointing, of ministry that God has for this church called Hope, it's going to happen through prayer and through fasting. Oh, because it's the access. Somebody say access. He's given us access to these powers that we can be able to have, that we can use, not to make a name for ourselves, but to be able to make Jesus famous. And as you look there, you look at verse 13, as they were casting out demons, as they were healing the sick, as they were healing the broken, the people came. Okay, let me say it again. As they were out there doing ministry, because they spent time in prayer, they spent time in fasting, as they were spent time doing those things and what God had given them access to, the people came. They weren't doing no tricks. They weren't doing no gimmicks. They didn't have no billboard. All they did was operate in the power. They didn't have no Facebook. They didn't have no Instagram. They didn't have no Twitter. They didn't have no emails. They didn't have no business cards. All they had was access to the power. And when they accessed the power that had been granted to them, the Bible says the people came. So if we're going to continue to operate in ministry that matters, that means we have to realize that the power that we operate in, that it is attractive, and people are looking to be a part of something that's progressive. People are looking to be a part of something that's moving. People are looking to be a part of something. Listen, I will never forget. Y'all know the one movie that comes on every year during Thanksgiving. The Five Heartbeats. Thanksgiving and Christmas, you're going to see the Five Heartbeats come on BET for some reason. I don't know why Thanksgiving and Christmas, but Thanksgiving and Christmas, the Five Heartbeats come on. Eddie Kane is outside. Yeah. And he asked him.
Keep it real, yeah.
He said, have you ever been a part of something that was bigger than you? He said, have you ever been connected to something that was bigger than you? Have you ever been a part of something that was so great, that was so magnificent, that was so on point, that you knew that it went beyond you, it went beyond just you, it went beyond who you are right now, but it's something about what you're connected to that you know that it's something so big, that it's something so amazing, that it's something so wonderful that you're just glad that you're a part of. Never hope, well, I don't know. Maybe it's just me. I might be a little biased because I'm the pastor. But we are on to something here. We are a part of something that is so great. We are a part of something that is so amazing. Yes, we are a part of the body of Christ as a whole. But there is something good that we got going on right here. And let me just put this shameless plug in there. If you are excited about your church and what God is doing in your church, you ought to be telling any and everybody about what God is doing at your church. You ought to be telling any and everybody, come see a man that told me everything about myself. Come see a man that healed me. Come see a man that forgave me. Come see a man that delivered me from my sins. Second thing, keep looking at verse 34. Look at verse 34, and I'm almost done because y'all real quiet on me today. But that's all right. That's all right. Jesus saw the huge crowd as he stepped from the boat. The Bible says that he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. Late in the afternoon, the disciples came to him and said, this is a remote place and it's already getting late. Send the people away. Jesus, let them go. They can fend for themselves. They can stop by nearby farms and villages and buy something to eat on their way. But get rid of them, Jesus. But look at verse 37. Jesus said to them, you know they're hungry. You feed them. You know they have need. You meet the need. When what? You always got somebody that when you're trying to cast vision, you always got that one person going to say, well, Pastor, when what? How are we going to do this, Pastor? When what? They asked. We'll have to work months to earn enough money to buy food for all these people. Ministry that matters is not just just attractive, but ministry that matters, get this, write this down, discerns the needs of the people. Let me say it again. Ministry that matters discerns the needs of the people. We can never forget that people matter in ministry. All right? Go this way. We must never forget that people matter when it comes to ministry. Okay? Let me speak to this intersection right here. We must never forget that when it comes to ministry, that people matter. Not your event, your event don't mean nothing if people aren't being blessed by it. The disciples see the same thing that Jesus sees. Jesus sees the people. Because get this, in the disciples' mind, they're still hung up on those words that Jesus said. Hey, let's go off in the cut. Let's go over here and rest for a little bit. Let's go over here and take a break. Because I know you're tired from all the ministry endeavors that you've done. Because listen, contrary to popular belief, ministry can be tiresome sometimes. You can get tired from ministry. Okay, all of my leaders should have said something on that one right there. And so they're still hung up on the words about taking a break and relaxing. Jesus sees the people. And the Bible says that Jesus had compassion on them. He says because they were like a sheep without a shepherd. So Jesus steps off this boat. Jesus steps out the boat. And he sees a throng of people coming after him. And his heart is moved with compassion for the people. And he says the people are like a sheep without a shepherd. You go back to Old Testament times. That when they had rulers, when they had judges, when they had kings, the kings and the judges served as a shepherd over the people. The shepherd's job was to keep the wolves away from the sheep. Amen. The shepherd's job was to lead and guide and to direct the sheep in the right direction they should go. Amen. The shepherd's job even extended to the point that when you had a rebellious sheep, when you had one that wanted to do his own thing and go his own way, that the shepherd loved the sheep so much that it will break their legs. And throw them on their backs and carry them back to the pasture so that they can heal and get them back on the right track. Jesus says, these people that we're looking at that need ministry are like a sheep without a shepherd. They're lost. They're unprotected. Use my sanctified imagination. Some of them probably have been eaten by, some of them probably have even been bitten by some wolves. Some of them have lost their way. Some of them are probably matted down from the weight from their wool. Because they never allowed the shepherd time to be able to shave off the old wool. They're out here. They're lost. They're unprotected. They're confused. They're hungry. They need love. They got needs. They need ministry. And he said, but look at y'all. My disciples. Who've been rolling with me all this time. You've been with me this long, but you still don't have my sense of discernment to be able to know that these people need hope. You're so concerned about taking a vacation that you're missing a prime ministry moment to meet the needs of these people. You're so concerned with checking this off your to-do list and going on to the next thing that you're missing. A ministry moment to meet the needs of these lost sheep. I don't care how well, I don't care how big we grow. I don't care what or how God expands us and how God grows us. We must never lose a heart of compassion for the lost. Yeah. Oh man, I thought this was a soul saving church. We should get excited about that. That our attention, that our agenda, our mindset should always be concerned for the left out and the let down. Our concern should always be for the outcast that nobody else want to deal with. Okay, here we go. Because if it was not for the grace of God, it could be you out there strung out on drugs. It could be you out there still holding around. Ooh, it was a good place but to have a flashback in your mind to thank God what he delivers you from. I may not be what I should be, but thank God I'm not what I used to be. He said, you're so concerned about taking this break. You're so concerned about having a vacation that you're missing out on a prime ministry moment. These people are here and they need ministry. They need service. And so I need you to come out of yourself and forget about yourself. And discern the needs of the people. Discern what they need right now. Discern what will meet immediate needs right now. Discern what will bring them closer to me. Discern.
Yeah. All right.
The needs that they have. Oh, Pastor Swim, what are you saying? I hope my ministry leaders caught on to that. That what we do when we're planning things out as we're making waves for ministry, listen, that we're not just doing something because we saw some other church do it and we think it'd be great for us. No. God is not calling for us to mimic another church. God's not calling for us to mimic another ministry. God's not calling for us to copycat what somebody else does. He said, if you get before my face in prayer, if you turn over your plate and fast and pray, I will give you original strategies. I will give you original plans to be able to meet the needs of my people. So he discerned these people, they are lost. He discerned that these people, they are confused. He discerned that most of all, these people are hungry. These people are hungry. And Jesus tells his disciples, he said, hey, these people, they are lost without, they're like sheep without a shepherd. And they tell Jesus, wait a minute, Jesus. We're trying to take our 15-minute break, Jesus. They're going to have to hold on just a second. He said, by the way, let's just send them away. Let's get them home. It's getting dark anyway. It's getting late anyway. Let's send them home. Just send them on their way. They can stop at the next exit and go to McDonald's or something. Yeah, I was supposed to laugh. There was no McDonald's in Jesus' name. Maybe somebody come to Sunday school because somebody thought that at the next exit there was really a McDonald's. Come to Sunday school. 8:30, there was no McDonald's in Jesus' time. They said, let them stop by the nearby farm. Let them stop by the nearby village to get something to eat. But Jesus told them in verse 37, no, you feed them. They're here. You have the power because you've already done it before. So you feed them. You operate and you do what I have called for you to do. Because I didn't just lay my hands on you so that you can walk around and say that Jesus laid his hands on me. No, I laid my hands on you so that greater things you can do than I've done. So ministry that matters is not just attractive. It is not only discern the needs of the people. But look at verse 38 and verse 41. Verse 38 says this, how much bread do you have, he asked. Go and find out. They came back and reported, we have five fish. We have five loaves of bread and two fish. Look at verse 41. Jesus took the five loaves and two fish, looked up towards heaven and blessed them, then breaking the loaves into pieces. He kept giving the bread to the disciples so they could distribute the food to the people. And he also divided the fish for everyone to share. Ministry that matters makes stewardship a priority. I'm in the book right there. Ministry that matters makes stewardship line. You've walked with this man. You've seen him raise the dead. You've seen him do what no other man does. And you have the audacity to challenge Jesus' vision when he says to feed them by saying, with what? Jesus, we are in a remote area. Ain't no same lot out here. Ain't no field out here. Ain't nobody growing no cabbage or some greens or some green tomatoes. We're out here in a remote area, Jesus. What are we to feed them with? So now they run into a problem. They have more need than they have resources. Have you ever, let's go ahead and make this personal real quick. Have you ever had a moment in your life where you have more bills than you have money? Have you ever been in a moment in your life where you had more bills than you had money? That all your bills were added up and you sitting there looking at your bills, looking at your check account, looking back at your bills, look at your check account again. Sneak over and look at your bills and they're still there. And you sneak over and look back at your check account and it's still the same amount. This is what the disciples are dealing with right here. They're dealing with this right here. They have more need than they have resources. But Jesus tells them something. He says, okay, go look and see what we already got. God, somebody should have shouted right there. He said, I want you to go back and look and see what's already in our possession. So the first thing that Jesus does, he challenges their mindset and he says, don't come and tell me what you don't have until you look to see what you do have. Don't tell me what you don't have until you go and look and see what you do have. Oh my God, I don't know who I'm talking to right now. When you get down on your knees to pray, don't tell God what you don't have, but look back and see what you already have in your possession. So they come back with the report. And they say, well, Jesus, all we got is two fish and five loaves of bread. That's all we got. We ain't got nothing else. Other verse, the other gospel say that it was over 5,000 people. Not including the women and the children. 5,000 plus people. Two fish. Five loaves of bread. Jesus says, you go look and see what we got. So they come back. They tell Jesus what he got. He says, hey, because we are the trustees over what God has blessed us with, we're going to maximize everything that we already have. Oh, God. I ain't getting no help on that one. I said, we're going to maximize everything that we have right now. I wish I had some folks that could go back to your broke moments where you realize how bad you didn't have nothing, but you made work the little bit that you had. You never knew that a can of peanut butter could last you for a whole month. You never knew that a loaf of bread could last you for 2 weeks when you take the 2 ends of the month. He says, I want you to maximize everything that you get. Hope, well, to say it again. Somebody praise God that little is much in the master's hand. I'm trying to set somebody up for a miracle. I'm trying to set somebody up for a blessing. I'm trying to introduce somebody to a miracle. Open up and praise your mouth. Open up your mouth and praise God that little is much in the master's hands. I don't know who needs God to make a way. I don't know who's looking for some provision. But God said, if you open up my mouth and praise me, I'll open up a door. Come on, if you praise me, he said, I'll take care of the bills. If you praise me, I'll open up a door. If you praise me, I'll give you a new job. If you open up your mouth, to maximize what they already have. See, during this time, though, while the disciples said, they said, hey, it would take us months to be able to earn enough money to be able to pay them, maybe have enough money to buy purchase food for all the 5,000 people. They operate in money. The money was called denarius. And so one denarius was worth a day's wages. So some theologians say that they would have to work 200 days in order to meet the present need that they had at the moment. Jesus tells them, I want you to maximize what you already got. I want you, you already told me what you got. You got two fish and five loaves of bread. But what I love so much about this, look at verse 41. Look at verse 41. Oh God, look at verse 41. Jesus realized who was his source.
Yeah.
See, ministry that matters understands that makes stewardship a priority. They understand to maximize everything that they have, but they also recognize and always remember who their source is. So what does Jesus do? Jesus takes the bread. The Bible says in verse 41, Jesus takes the five loaves and two fish. He looks up towards heaven and he blessed them, then breaking the loaves into pieces. He kept giving. God, y'all missed that. Because if you saw what I saw, somebody would have been cooking for Cocoa Pop. The Bible says that when he broke it into pieces, he kept giving. Where's my church at this morning? The Bible says that when he had looked up towards heaven, when he had blessed it. So what did he say, preacher? He took what he had. He said, Father, I know what we got ain't much, but I thank you for what you've already blessed us with. So I'm giving it back to you, God. And as I'm giving it back to you, I'm expecting that every need that I have, that you're going to take care of it. And the Bible says that when he broke it into pieces, that as they were giving it, the Bible says that as he gave it, everybody walked away with some leftover. I don't know who I'm talking to this morning, but I already got my answer. God told me to tell Hopewell Missionary Baptist Church, 400 East Main Street, that whatever we get, we thank and praise God for what we get. And when we give it to him, he's going to keep giving it. I don't know who I'm talking to this morning. You ain't got much in your hands. You don't know how wedding's going to be made. You got bills that's due at the end of the month, and you know how they're going to get paid. But God says, sit the little bit that you got. Thank me for it. Bless me for it. Acknowledge me for it. And watch and see that something big is about to happen. Y'all missed it. Y'all missed it. means that the giving was reoccurring and it continued to happen. The giving was not just a one-time event, but it was something that continued to happen. But why did the giving continue to happen? Because Jesus recognized who his source was. His source was his Father. And he acknowledged his Father for what he had. Because he gave it to the Lord. He thanked him. And he blessed him. He thanked them and he blessed them. He thanked them and he blessed them. And when he thanked them and when he blessed them, the giving never stopped. Just happened there in that text. The Bible says, Jethro, that when they get down to the inn, everybody walked away with a leftover basket of food. Over 5,000 people walked away with a leftover basket full of food.
Oh, yes.
Thank you. Yes, Lord. Pastor Swims, what did you say? That this house.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
I declare and I decree this house would never lack. Look at somebody looking at me, cross out real quick. I don't go to Hopewell. I told you until about 12:30 you're part of Team Hopewell. So when I made that declaration, that went for you too. So let me say it again. That this house, there will be no lack in this house. We may have seasons not having much, but we're going to always have something. Because this house would never lack. Because everything we get, we thank them and we bless them. We give it to them, we thank them and we bless them.
Yes.
The dream stayed with me for weeks, days. Told the Elder Hodges about it. I said, what is it? I don't understand. What is it? I think I know a little bit of what the Lord is saying. What is he saying? What is he trying to get you to see? There's an anointing that's upon Hopewell. And the anointing goes beyond denomination affiliation. It's not about being Baptist. It's not about being AME, CME, Cogent, whatever you are. I'm not knocking no denomination at all. But the anointing that is upon us goes beyond that. So what God is looking for, he's looking for a church, he's looking for a people. Access to me. They want me and all of me. If I give them stuff, fine. If not, fine. hunger their plates and fast. That when the hunger's pains come down on them, I'm going to eat off his word, eat off his word. I'm going to get in his face, I'm going to get in his presence. Looking for a church that will say, listen, we're about ministry. We're about ministry. We're about meeting the needs of people. We're about meeting people right where they are. We're about giving our testimonies and sharing what our life was like before Christ came into it. How jacked up, how messed up we are. And better yet, listen, we're not as messed up as we used to be, but we're still messed up because I still need them. Don't you think because you've been saved for so long that you don't need him? You still need him because you're still messed up. Yeah, you got a degree. Yeah, you got a suit. Yeah, you got a nice wig on, but you still need him. I had hair and I need him, and I ain't got no hair, and I still need him now. So I'm looking for people that will discern. That will discern. Oh, Pastor, I know we do this every year, but I think God is shifting us to do something else. Pastor, I think God is shifting us in a different vein. I really feel the Lord leading in a different direction. We need to change up this thing that we do. Because we want to meet people's needs. And let me tell you this. In meeting people's needs, impact is not always indicated by numbers. Impact is indicated by transformation. Yeah. Let me say it again. Impact is not always indicated by numbers. Numbers are fine, numbers are great. Right. But impact is indicated by transformed lives. Yeah. He's looking for a church. Person comes in off the street. And they need help. And they need Jesus. And they're so desperate for them that they bust in this place and break all types of protocol that we can shift. And meet them where they are. We must never lose our heart of compassion. Oh, because it was a compassionate man by the name of Jesus that drew us. And the same compassion he gave us, we are to be extensions of that compassion.
Well,
are we going to be a church that whatever he gives to us, we're going to give it back to him? And we're going to thank him? And we're going to bless him? And we're going to magnify him. And we're going to lift him up. And everything we have need of, he's going to supply. God is calling for us to come higher. But to come high, you got to get low first. Pastor Barnes, one of our former pastors, used to say something to us preachers all the time. He said, if you want to see where I'm going, meet me in prayer. If you want to see what the Lord is saying, meet me in prayer. He used to always say, I'm preaching to a church that ain't showing up. And you say, Pastor Brown, what are you talking about? Then he says, 7 o'clock, I'm here. What talking about me? But he was talking about the souls. So I'm preaching to a church that's not even saved yet. I'm preaching to a church that's still lost. To a church that's waiting for us to come to where they are.
All right.
this call, this challenge. It's not just on me, but it's on us. So stop saying, Pastor, where we gonna go? Because I'm gonna do what Jesus did. You go. You go. I'm gonna go, but you go. Don't wait for me to go, but you go. You feed them. Friday, October 30th, I'm gonna do the invitation and we're about to go. Friday, October 30th is our quarterly prayer encounter that we do. It's unscripted. Normally the prayer team, they have an agenda for how we're going to pray and what we're going to pray for. Holy Spirit told me this needs to be unscripted. I'm challenging my leadership to be here on the 30th. From 7 to 10. Jesus is always going to hit the disciples. Can you not tarry me for an hour? You want my power, but you don't want to talk to me. You want my anointing, but you don't want to spend time with me. No, tarry with me for an hour. Challenging my leadership team to meet me here. As we fast and pray, there's going to be a day when we're going to fast on that Friday, October 30th. Our fast will conclude at the end of our court, as our, of our prayer session that night at 10 o'clock. Not just my leadership team, but my church. Not just the church, but the community. If you're coming to get a break from your husband and your kids, this ain't the house for you that night. Because I need to know that I'm desperate for Jesus and need him to meet me as we seek his face through prayer, through worship. Searching for him. 7 to 10 p.m. that night, the last Friday of October. So we seek his face. I don't want to do ministry like I always done. I don't want to preach like I've always preached. I want to teach like I always taught. I know there's more of him than I haven't even gotten yet. But I'm desperate enough to be in pursuit of him. Because when I get him, so much that's in him. So much that's in him. And we need him. If you're here today and you don't know Lord Jesus Christ, your personal Lord and Savior, we invite you to come and know him. If you don't know him, if you don't know him, we invite you to come and know him.